This is Science 2034. 20 years ago, the Science Coalition was formed to strengthen federal support for basic scientific and engineering research. We tell the stories of what federally funded research has made possible and what will be reality 20 years from now. Our guest today, Dr. Shirley Ann Jackson, president of the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in Troy, New York.
U.S. leadership in science and technology is critical for a number of reasons. First of all, more than 50% of our GDP growth since World War II has come from developments and discoveries in science and the technological innovations built on those discoveries. If you think about the internet, the work that supported and led to the development of the internet actually began in the 1960s. If you look at all of the great work that's being done vis-a-vis personalized medicine, genomics in medicine, a lot of that links to the mapping of the human genome. That project went on in the 1990s. So however you look at it, one looks at a stream that can date anywhere from 20 years before to 50 or more years before, sometimes 100, before the real fruits of scientific discovery come out. But all of them are there. And so research, by definition, undergirds the kinds of things we depend upon, whether it relates to human health or to our national security, to energy security, to our ability to help uplift lives around the globe. Science and technology always are at the root of that. Well, I believe in the concept of a window in time, that we all have our window in time. And if the window opens and one steps through it, one can think of it as a portal, a door, whatever metaphor one wishes to use. So my life was changed because of the confluence of two things. The 1954 Brown versus Board of Education decision that desegregated the public schools. And that happened very quickly here in Washington, D.C., where I happened to grow up. But the other critical was the Soviet launch of the Sputnik 1 satellite. And that galvanized the nation's attention on what essentially was a science-based defense race with the Soviets. We called it the space race. And the nation had a uniformity of focus. That led to a lot of investment by the government and even by private enterprise, where there was a desire to identify those who had talent and interest in science and math and engineering and related fields, and importantly, to invest in the education of young people in those fields. I benefited from that. That opening of that particular window in time, driven by a national commitment to support basic research and to support the education of young people in science and math and engineering and technology, made all the difference in my life. The U.S. is globally preeminent. To remain so, we need to be strong in those things that undergird that leadership and work in scientific research, the education of young people in those fields. That preeminence allows us to attract talent from around the world to this country. The students we educate today are the ones who will drive the innovations of tomorrow. They will make the discoveries in basic research, but they will only make those discoveries if they're given the opportunity to make them based on support for research, support for education in science and technology related fields. That's why Science 2034 is so important, because we're talking about the young people that we're educating, that places like Rensselaer are educating today. But the young child born today will be in college in 2034. And so it is so important that we maintain those opportunity pathways, not just for education, but education is key. But in fact, to make those kinds of investments that will undergird our economy. And that, in my mind, rests with those fundamental things. It is very important to make the case for support for basic research in science and engineering and related fields. And it is exactly the time to make that argument. It is a mistake to think that because budgets are tight, that we can just drop our support in these areas. And because in dropping the support in these areas, we're dropping support for the education of the young people who will make all the difference to our economy. And so we've got to not think so much about supporting basic research, but through the Science 2034 initiative to articulate, particularly to the members of the Congress, that it is investment, not merely expenditure. And investment means one is building for the future, understanding that it takes a long time to educate a high-performing scientist or engineer. It takes decades because the education is cumulative. And then in order for someone, whatever their interest may be, to persist, to stay with it, they have to believe there's a career path that makes sense for them in terms of that investment. Because it is certainly true that people of that kind of talent can do any number of other things and will be tempted in certain cases to do it. But people, if they invest in their education, they want to put it to work. But if they can't put it to work in the area that they are trained in, then they still will put it to work, being motivated people. And so they'll follow where the opportunity pathway is. So as a country, we've got to decide what kind of country do we want in terms of the strength of our economy, in terms of the nature of our security, in terms of our energy security, in terms of our health, in terms of economic growth, and the provision of even more jobs and employment. And if we think that through, I would like to believe that that then will lead to investment. And so Science 2034 is right on the money. You're taking stock of what has gone on with the Science Coalition for 20 years, but then to look forward in terms of not only making predictions, but predictions come true as a consequence of human effort. Human effort has to be supported, and therefore basic research and the education of those who do the work and the support of those who've already made a commitment to this kind of work is so critical.